Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Leadership in Politics with Dr. Abraham. On the show with me today is an exceptional guest, Mr. Simon Haig. Welcome.
Thank you. It's great to talk to you. I've been watching your work for a long time, and I feel very honored and privileged to be talking to you at last. It's wonderful.
It's likewise. I'm a big fan of the work you do, and it's wonderful to be able to meet with you and shine a light on the beautiful work you're doing. You are doing excellent work, and I want to share what you do with my audience, with your audience, really. You are an executive coach. You are a strategist. You are a champion of inclusion, diversity, and equity. You're a mentor. You are a coach. You're an attorney. What is there something you haven't done, or you're not?
I've done a lot. I've done a lot of things over 28 years, and I've lived in 5 countries. I've lived in Australia. I spent some time in the States. I've lived in the UK. I currently live in Ireland. I've lived in Poland for a bit. And I guess, Dr. Abraham, you know, I for me, life is very precious, right? And there are so many opportunities. And, you know, I started life, as you said, as a private practice lawyer. I then worked for a couple of US companies. I was the first legal counsel for Dell here in UK, Ireland. And but I think I realized very quickly after 13 years as a lawyer that what I really enjoyed was trying to figure out complex issues within organizations around organizational design and the people side of things, and then making a solution, a pathway simple, right? So allowing people to really unraveling what seemed to be complex in an organization and providing a simple pathway for others. So the last 8 years, 9 years of my life has been around coaching, mentoring, training, writing books around what appeared complicated around business leadership, brand, and mindset growth simpler than people imagine. I think a lot of corporates hide behind complexity. It's not complex. It's about people. It's about relationships. So that's really
it makes them feel important, huh? When there's complex things. So absolutely. You simplify the process.
That's what I do. Yeah.
You want to reach the mindset. You want to reach a mindset where you can say the process could be easier than it is presented, and this is how you look at it. And as a strategist, You put a mechanism in place where people can benefit for your coaching, because you're an executive coach. You are with Marshall Goldsmith.
My journey with Marshall Goldsmith has been amazing. 5 years ago, nearly 6 years ago, I wrote my second book, Deal Making for Corporate Growth, when I was in Australia. And I thought, I need somebody to write the foreword. So I looked on LinkedIn, the power of LinkedIn, and I looked at Richard Branson and famous people. And I came across Marshall Goldsmith, who I hadn't heard of at that time. Mm-hmm. And I connected with him on LinkedIn and I said, Marshall, will you write the foreword to my book? I was very impressed with his work, obviously. And within days he responded and said, yes. And impressive. So he wrote the foreword to that book. He wrote the foreword to my last book, How to Be a Better Deal Closer. While I was in Australia, I thought, well, hang about, maybe I should look at the Marshall Goldsmith coaching methodology. Mm-hmm. So I qualified, I'm a certified Marshall Goldsmith coach. I'm also an associate member of the organization as well. And, you know, I am so indebted to Marshall in terms of the example he has set to me. And, you know, for him, it's about paying it back. You know, he's been so kind to me. He's endorsed my work. He came to my book launch in Ireland. You know, he's endorsed my work on my website. And so I can't but not pay it back, you know. For me, it's about passing on his goodwill to others, which is just
part of what I do, you know. Pay it forward. So yeah, absolutely. So he's leading with humility. This is really something nice to hear. Every person I interviewed, every now and then, the name comes out. And one of these days, I hope I'm going to shine a light on the work he's doing as well, because it's impressive. Yeah. I'm glad that you shared that as well. So you are a champion of inclusion. You talked about inclusion and diversity and equity.
Yeah.
Tell me a little bit of what you're doing now.
Well, what drove this was I spent 6 years in Australia working with Aboriginal, Indigenous people. I was the CEO of an American company, an Indigenous American company in Australia called Nana Development Corporation. And I was inspired by the cultural aspect and the relationships of Indigenous people. So it's deep in my heart. And then I moved back to Ireland and I see so many problems in corporations, right? So much is sub-optimized. And so a year ago, I met up with an amazing American woman by the name of Elizabeth Suarez. And we came up with a project to, and we're now working with two other partners from the States, Nigel Sonariwo and Weiyang. And so we've just launched a business called inclusioninleadership.com. And the premise of the business is that if you can imagine, I always talk about the three R's of business. Every business is governed by revenue, risk, and reputation. It's like a triangle, revenue, risk, and reputation. And for businesses to drive revenue, risk, and reputation, they need to, what I call, drive cohesive and inclusive growth. If you're not cohesive and if you're not inclusive, you risk damaging your reputation, you risk risk, and you risk not suboptimal revenue. And so we've come up with a methodology through coaching and consulting to say to C-suites, if you do these five things well, which I'll talk about, you can improve your profitability and your brand value. And the five things are diversity and inclusion, processes and procedures, gender balance, cultural cohesion or cultural assimilation, making sure that different cultures in an organization work well, ethical win-win communication, and very poignantly today during the pandemic, is how do workforces that are remote work cohesively. So if you do those five things well, we can demonstrate that you can actually improve your profitability and brand value. And you know, we're blessed. Dave Ulrich, we're nice. Who I know you've interviewed. Nice. We've done a piece of work with him, and we're hoping to do more with him. We are just about to start working next week with Southampton University in the UK, and there's more coming. So for me, it's a real passion, Dr. Abraham, because so many businesses are missing out on optimizing their processes. And at the end of the day, you know, it's all about brand and reputation. And if you don't look after all those aspects of inclusion, you risk, you know, employer branding being damaged. You risk market position being damaged. So it's a business imperative. It is a nice to have, but it's also a business imperative.
Why is it nice to have? Why is it important for a company to be inclusive? And what does it mean to be inclusive? When we say inclusion, diversity, equity, what these terms mean to you?
To me, it means the opposite of lip service. It means not just having, you know, people of color in a call center, right? That's lip service, right? That's just ticking a box. It means everybody, every human being on this planet, there's 8 billion people on this planet, right? Whether we like each other or not, we are all equal, right? So it's about giving equality from the starting blocks, right? It's giving true equality from the starting blocks, right? Now, we all find our own way through life, but it's getting rid of discrimination. It's getting rid of barriers. And it's being truly, and there's a difference between diversity and inclusion. For me, diversity is sending out an invite for a dinner party, whereas inclusion is having people sitting at your table. It's doing this properly and, you know, from a real perspective, and it's good, and it's ethical, and it's humanistic. But the point I'm making is, you know, and I've learned this in Australia, you know, through Aboriginal economic development, by spending $8 billion on Indigenous economic development, there was a study done over there that the GDP of Australia could be doubled, $16 billion. So this is good for business. It's good for humans, but it's also good for business. The problem is changing the mindset, I'm afraid to say, of middle-aged white males. They're scared of change.
Why do you think there's a fear of having others on the same table? Now, when you have them, I have a follow-up question. When you have them on the table, are they an invitee guest? They eat and leave, or they make a decision what kind of food they eat?
No, I think it's the latter, right? It's not just eating and leaving, right? But it's a choice. It's the choice that matters. And, you know, back to your point about why are they scared? You know, I wrote an article a couple of years ago called Gender Balance for Better Business. Published article in the UK, Globe Law and Business. And from a gender perspective, right, I was amazed at just how many, you know, there are biases everywhere, right? And I think it really goes back to 17th century, 18th century Europe, where, you know, the foundations of the church, politics, business, military, these were all white male, you know, from Spain and Netherlands and the UK. And so you know, in the Western world, it's been shaped over the last 500 years. And for the white male in the Western world to see this changing is challenging. It's challenging, you know, but it is changing and it has to change. And my point is, and I think this COVID pandemic period, this is a circuit breaker period, right? I mean, businesses are struggling. It's like a three-legged stool. You know, on the one hand, you know, they have to keep their costs and efficiencies down because, you know, they don't know what's happening, while at the same time promoting positivity, while at the same time projecting forward. I work with CEOs and CFOs, and they don't know what to do. They just don't know what to do. So I think now is a really good time to really definitively change mindsets. And we're starting to see that. It's never going to be easy. Change is never easy.
I don't really talk about white and black when I present or even when I deal in life. I don't see it that way, but it is a fact of life. And it is a white male, let's say. And you're dealing with an executive who has the mindset of the old times. But also the challenge you have here is that a white male, or it could be a black male for heaven's sake, build the foundation, build the company, and that's his own baby. And he has to work now with the society's rules and regulations, and he has to employ others. These others could be others, really, like different groups. And then black is going to employ white, male is going to employ female, young is going to employ the old. You want to include all. The question to you for all of them, regardless if it's white, black, old, or female, or male, why inclusion is important? There's something else I'm looking for. What is it?
For me, it's important because, you know, from a humanistic perspective, right, we're all in this together, okay? From a humanistic perspective, and also from a creativity perspective. I had no conception of their views of creativity, of their views of listening, you know, that they listened in a different way. They had a different way of explaining. It was through storytelling. And so for me, it's about the more inclusion you have and diversity sits within that, I think you improve your chances of innovation, right? Innovation, because you have much more diversity of thought, right? That's the first thing. I think that's really critically important. But to allow that, a bit like Apple back in 1999, Apple was on its knees as a company and it allowed some engineers to come up with something. They gave them 6 months and they came up with the iPod, right? So I think there has to be an environment of taking chances, of taking risk, right? And see what comes out of that. If you don't have an expansive inclusion mindset, I think you're missing out on things. So purely from a business innovation imperative perspective, it's worth it, right? It's worth it.
That's what absolutely. It brings. That's what inclusion means.
Absolutely.
Means success and effectiveness to the organization. Fairness is also important. You have to be fair as well. And this is where equity comes into play.
Absolutely.
You are what I'm observing, dear Simon. I'm observing humanity. I'm observing and sensing empathy, compassion. You talked about the human being. And not every individual I know or you know has this passion, especially when you talk to a trainer or a coach or mentor, an executive who has the mindset of a capitalist, the old-time capitalist. How can you bring humanity to this individual? It's the I in him, the I in her saying, it's I in my company. So there is really no spirit of collaboration. It's the competition and we have to dominate. Yeah. But what I sense humanity in your approach. I sense a level of resiliency. These come from somewhere. They don't just, they're not built on. They're not part of our psyche. You bring them along through experience. Tell me about that.
Yeah. So, you know, I've been on a journey. So I was, you know, I started life 13 years as a corporate lawyer, and I was a capitalist. Like I was an unashamed young man in my 20s, 30s who cared about money and status, right? I've been there. And in my early 40s, I always thought that there was something more than that, right? And for me, you know, discrimination, it was never, like there's bias everywhere, but I was always very open-minded. I also went on I've also experienced some trauma and some tragedy in my life, which I write about today. And we all have our own journey, right? We all have a journey. And I've been in a dark place 12 years ago, and I know what it's like to be in a desperately difficult place where all you require is one grain of sand of hope from another human being. And I've been in that place, right? And it's often that one grain of sand of hope. Somebody says something that pulls you back from the ledge or whatever it is. And I've been there, right? So, and that was very, very visceral and very raw, right? Very raw. And And I'll never forget that. And I've met some wonderful spiritual people since then, including Aboriginal people in Australia and others. And so for me, right, for me personally, yes, I'm for profit. I'm about making money, right? But I can't be honest with myself if I'm anything other than honest, right? And so for me, I talk about three words: willingness. I have to be willing, right? I have to be open-minded, right? But above all else, I have to be honest, not just with you and others. If I'm not honest with myself, I'm going to be not only mentally sick, I'm going to be spiritually sick, and I'm going to be physically sick. So this is a self-preservation thing. But imagine if all humans were honest, like truly honest. And honest means saying no, right? And so how that manifests in my work. So I suppose you could say that's resilience, right? Because I've learned to cope, right? But also it's all about, you know, providing assurance and helping others. And for me, you know, I use three words as a leader. It's important to be calm. You need to be calm, right? You need to be compassionate, but you also need to be courageous, which comes back to honesty, right? So sometimes I have to say no. Sometimes as a boss, you have to say, you have to leave the company. But as long as you say it calmly and compassionately, then you're doing the right thing. And so for me, and there's three parts of resilience. There's self-resilience, how I cope in life. There's societal resilience, how I cope in society. And there's life resilience. So this is just something I've picked up through the years, and I'm very acutely attuned. As we said before, you can't teach resilience, right? It's something that you pick up through life's experiences. And it's something now that I see when I talk to somebody, I can almost sense whether they're almost a barometer of where they are on the resilience level, you know, and particularly now it's such an important thing. Along with assertiveness and awareness and influencing skills. But I guess I'll finish on this. Once you recognize this in yourself, you have a responsibility. You've got to stop ego from poking through. Once ego starts poking through, you're in trouble. So you need to operate, come back and operate through vulnerability, but courageous vulnerability.
And it's okay to admit you're vulnerable. It's okay to say, I need help. It's okay to
Absolutely. I've been there.
Is tragedy part of making the individual better?
I think tragedy, if the individual learns from the experience, feeds into what I call awareness, right? For me, it's about self-awareness. And so, you know, I went through my 20s, 30s, and early 40s. It was like a rush. It was all about making money. It was all about achievement and status. And I didn't really notice what was going on around me. And I didn't really connect. I wouldn't have been talking to you 5 years ago. Right? I wouldn't have been talking to Sally Helgeson and Dave Ulrich and Marshall Goldsmith, because I was so busy in my own head, right? And I wasn't watching what was going on. And I think it's also comes back to alignment. Hortense Le Gentil has written an amazing book called Aligned, right? Very simply written. It's not an academic book. And for her, and this is part of my work, when I coach and mentor people, I say to them, right, I give the example of me, right? There were two versions of me up to 2 years ago. There was the corporate version on LinkedIn, and I was clean shaven and I wore a tie. There was the two versions of me. There was the corporate stiff version, and then there was the relaxed version inside. And for years, I used to think, because I'm a lawyer and because I've written books, I have to be this corporate stiff version, right? And I went through some mentoring and some coaching a couple of years ago. And the person who took me through that said, Simon, unless you are aligned, unless it's truly you that comes through, people are not really going to connect with you. And if people don't connect, you're not going to hear, right?
So the authentic you become authentic.
That's critically, critically important. Mm. My concern today, and it's funny, I've started doing some work in this, is that particularly men, and particularly, you know, middle class, I'm talking about white men in particular in Anglo-Saxon communities, there's still very much this, you've got to be macho and you can't show your feelings and men don't cry. That's not authentic. Every human being cries, right? Yeah. I've seen Marshall Goldsmith shed tears, right?
Nice.
We all cry. We all have emotions. And I think if we let our guard down, it doesn't mean surrender, but it means be you. And if you're you, people connect with you, and also you hear more, and it's a virtuous cycle. But it's very hard to break the old cycle.
So becoming you, it really changed you to be better. It changed you to be more authentic, which and transparent and better communicator. But inside you is the most impact and change, right? Because there's a peace. There is tranquility of sort. Nobody can feel it unless you become authentic, right? There is no...
It's funny you should say that. And I'll give you a graphical example of what you're saying. About it, just over a year ago, I have somebody who does my marketing and branding work, Robbie Caffrey. I'll shout out Robbie Caffrey. And I said to him, I'm not making enough progress. I'm not talking to the right people. I'm not getting enough work. And he said, Simon, it's like you're looking at the Marshall Goldsmiths of this world, and they're in this big shiny mansion in Beverly Hills, and they're behind a door and a big driveway and a gate, and you're at the end of that, right? And you're looking at this, but you're pushing too hard. Before Christmas this last year, he said to me, Simon, because he's seen the progress and he's seen the authentic alignment, and there has been progress. And he said, Simon, I've watched. You've not only opened the gate, you've walked down the driveway and that door's open, right? And that sends shivers down my spine when I say that. And that's only because I don't push anymore. It's because I treat people with respect, right? I treat people with respect, right? When I say I'm going to send an email at 6 p.m., I send it, right? It doesn't matter how junior it is. You just do these things because treat people with respect. And the world, whether it's the universe, whether you believe in God, it is watching, right? Not always. And I guess the flip side of this is you do have to be careful. The flip side of this, you have to protect yourself and put boundaries up, which is, again, where awareness, because there are people who will take advantage. But again, that's the flip side of that situational awareness. It's a magical thing, but it takes, and I think you have to be ready. I wasn't ready at 50. I'm ready at 53.
And more as you age, as you become wiser and wiser. And we need this wisdom so you can share it with others. And I'm very grateful for this insight. You mentioned alignment, and I can't pass it without mentioning something else. So you said alignment, which align your inner self, your inner abilities, capabilities with the outside world and what the outlook will become. Give me balance in alignment. How important is balance, alignment, or is it something in between? Give me balance in alignment.
I think balance is, I think it's a critical part of alignment. And and it's funny you should mention about balance, because another way of looking at alignment for me, I talk about mindset and mindfulness, right? And I give the example of, you know, the seesaws that you see in children's playgrounds, one end goes up and then it goes down and goes like that. Mm-hmm. A lot of people push, right? And they say, right, I'm going to set the mindset, I'm going to create goals, and I'm going to go for it, right? But what they don't do before they do that is set the honest intent, which is the mindfulness. So for example, if I say to you, right, tomorrow morning, I'm going to go swimming in the ocean at 6 a.m. and it's cold, the sea is cold here, I set the mindset, I go to bed, and I'm going to wake up. In the morning, I wake up, the alarm goes off, I walk to the beach, and I put my toes in the water, and the water is very cold, right? That's when I need to practice mindfulness. And mindfulness is, mindset is setting the intention, whereas mindfulness is sustaining that intention. And that's where most people fail, right? The hardest thing is to keep sustaining that mindset, right? And that, you know, I think you need to be aligned with yourself, right? You need to be fully aligned. And that, for me, that's the balance, right? It's the balance of mindset and mindfulness. I think that's the way I like to look at balance. You can't just keep saying, I'm going to set goals. And there's a really, really good book by an American neurosurgeon called James Doty. And the book is my favorite all-time book. And it's called Into the Magic Shop. And he was a young boy, true story, very graphic novel. He's performing brain surgery, and then he flashes back to when he was a 12-year-old boy. And he came from similar background to me, a bit of a broken family. And he was a broken young kid and walked into a magic shop in Salinas Valley in California. And this old lady saw something in him, a frail, broken young boy. And she said, if you come back every day for 6 weeks, I'll teach you magic. And he did. She didn't teach him magic. She taught him the four tricks really to have an aligned, successful life. And this is what I talk about in my work. Number one is relax your body. Number two, calm your mind. Find ways of doing that. Number four, which is what most people do, is set their goals and intents. But what 95% of people skip is number three, which is the hardest thing, which is the mindfulness balance, which is if you don't honestly set your intent about what you want to do in life, number four, the goals aren't going to come to fruition. And for me, at the age of 53, I can honestly say that my purpose in life, I never thought what my purpose was, but now my purpose in life is to absorb as much knowledge as I can about all things growth, business, leadership, brand, and mindset. Absorb it, distill it, simplify it, pass it on to others. Yes, I want to make some money, but really it's about inspiring others to be the best version of themselves. And when I say that, I just reflected about my very dark days 12 years ago, and it's amazing. It is actually amazing. I'm sitting here talking to you about this when I was broken 12 years ago, and now I'm inspiring others. So that's, for me, the journey.
The journey with passion. What you just described is passion. You found your purpose. You found your purpose. Yeah, you found your purpose. But the passion is what's driving you. Really, it's the passion to help others, to be an instrument of help. Serving others is a good thing.
Yeah, it's about helping others build their confidence, right? It's about matching their confidence with their capability. And my challenge today is, anybody would say it, my wife would say it, my clients say it, my business partners, you're full of passion, Simon. Slow down. You know, you're gonna burn out. And I'm very aware of that, because once you find your passion, nothing else really matters, right? That's what I have to do. And Marshall does the same. For him, it's about passing back everything he's learned. And so I have to also be very present and very aligned and very aware that I need to take time out, and I need to protect me as well. You know, yes. I need to mind me.
And the way you do that is by being mindful. Mindfulness is the presence, is knowing the now, knowing the presence. Have you ever reached a level where you cultivate your passion or regulate your passion?
You carry on.
The way you do that is through mindfulness. The way you can do that is become, of course, emotional intelligence is fine, self-awareness is fine, is being mindful of who you are and the present time. And if you do that, you're able to somehow regulate your passion. You know how to be empathetic with others and so on.
Yeah. No, I agree. And, you know, Eckhart Tolle's book, The Power of Now, I use an analogy there, right? Because I'm very mindful of my mind, right? The human mind can make or break a human, right? If I were locked in a padded cell, right, with just my mind, I would be in trouble, right? And so mindfulness, ironically, is not about the mind. It's about getting out of the mind, right? And so I use this analogy when I teach people. Particularly today with social media, we all have this low-grade anxiety. The news is bad. 95% of the news is negative. Social media is on all the time. And so people are in this low-grade anxiety all the time. And I say, to enable you to be truly focused and to have a passion and a purpose and to be value of others, you need to find ways to switch your brain off, to switch your mind. So I use the analogy that Eckhart Tolle said. If you need to drill a hole in the wall in your house, you go to the shed, you get the drill, you drill the hole, you put the drill back in the shed, and you've done your job. So try and use your mind like a drill. And this is very important for me. So when I have to do a piece of work like this, I have to focus. I say to my mind, focus, right? I do the work. When I finish it, I switch my mind off and I go for a walk or I have coffee. And I now have cultivated the ability to use my mind as a tool and observe it and then switch it off when I don't need it. So, for example, every day, I go for a long walk with my wife, maybe 7-8 mile walk every night. And during that, I now have cultivated the ability not to navigate my mind, but just to listen to the twigs under my feet. It hasn't come easy. It's not easy, but I've cultivated, because that's really... And initially, I thought that was a waste of time, but it actually, it's like working the brain, taking that mindful period actually reinforces and builds the strength of the mind. It's counterintuitive, but it's very important.
Actually, it's essential. So this is what you prescribe, because my follow-up question was, let's simplify the process for people to have a mindset that is not complicated, not complex. So, and I was going to ask you this question, and you start prescribing by actually living in the now, by seeing nature instead of just thinking of having the mind working all the time. Is that part of the prescription of how people can simplify their lives and have a mindset that is beneficial to them and the environment they're in?
Absolutely. You know, it's about, you know, if you want to be successful, right, if you want to be a catalyst for growth, if you want to do well, if you want to reach your goals, you have to focus, right? You have to focus. And focus isn't just about constant work and attention. Focus is, as you said, requires balance, right? Yes. So to be able to focus, you need to have periods of time when you're not focused. And there's also another aspect to this, which I think is really important as well. And there are three words. You need to love yourself, right? You really need to love and respect and cherish yourself, right? And so
Simon, to what extent would you love yourself?
So what I mean by that is I use three words. When I coach and mentor people, I say, I'm careful about when I start talking about this, but I would ask you, A, do you like yourself, right? Do you like yourself? That's the first question. Most people don't even ask themselves this question. B, do you respect yourself? So it's like and respect. And C, do you trust yourself? Nobody ever asked me that stuff, right? It's quite deep when you think about it. It's quite confronting and challenging when you think about it. You know, if you ask me, Simon, do you like, respect, and trust yourself? I'd think, are you mad? Of course I do. I'm me. But nobody really thinks about this stuff. So to really reflect on that stuff requires quite a lot of work, right? It requires a lot of work about self-honesty and to spend that time on yourself. You've got to have a fair amount of compassion and love for yourself to bother to do that, right? To want to become better. So that's what I mean. Do you trust, like, and respect yourself? And to actually answer that honestly and not flippantly, you've got to have a lot of compassion for yourself to give yourself time to work that stuff out. It doesn't come easy. Nothing comes easy.
Self-compassion is not easily practiced. And the reason I asked you to what extent is love yourself. Probably this message is both of us would advocate for. Love yourself to an extent acceptable where you don't go beyond, where you don't see others anymore. Love yourself to an extent, but always be compassionate and empathetic to others
I agree.
I'm enjoying this conversation, Simon. This will never end.
No, I agree. It's wonderful.
It's wonderful. I'm thankful for your insights. Thankful for your time.
You're welcome.
I hope my audience has enjoyed and are enjoying this conversation from a talented strategist, mindset changer, change maker, the Simon Haig. I do thank you. Is there anything else you want to cover? Where can people find you? Anything you want to let people know about you in addition?
It's been wonderful, and I feel privileged to have had this chat. I've been drawn to you for about a year. I've been watching you interview other people, and it's been really special for me. And you've actually brought some thought process out of me I've never said to anybody else. So it's been great. I'm active on LinkedIn all the time, so people can connect with me on LinkedIn. Or through my website, simonhaig.com, HAIGH.com, or email me, simon@simonhaig.com. I always respond to everybody, right? You know, as long as it's a bona fide request, that's important to me, because I don't like ignoring people. Like, you don't know who needs help. So I always at least respond, right? So that's important to say.
That's very true. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much. Hope you enjoyed this conversation.